But this girl was like, no, you're not Chinese. And then I was like, hold up. Let me speak my bad Chinese real quick to let you know. And then she was like, yeah, I said, you're not Chinese. And I was like,
damn.
Oh. All right. Yo. Everybody. No. Can you, first of all, real quick, can you take off your hat real quick, please?
Why?
Just to show that you got the dreads cut off. Woo! Oh, your head can breathe now.
Bro, I feel 10 pounds lighter.
Guys, we got a special podcast. You know why? Because we were just having a conversation the other day with some other ABC friends, American-born Chinese. But a lot of Chinese Americans cannot speak Chinese. So today, in this video, we are about to explore 10 reasons why Chinese Americans suck at Chinese.
I think we can all relate on a different level. So I guess maybe the first thing that we should establish is, what is everybody's journey with the Chinese language?
Well, I've been speaking Chinese, in particular Cantonese, my whole life because, you know, I'm a fob. My parents are fobs.
I'm born in America. The majority of the language being spoken till I was probably like 3 was Cantonese. We get sent to Mandarin school. It's run by these really strict Taiwanese ladies.
You get murked.
Oh my goodness. They're keeping me in at recess because can't sing the songs. I'm crying.
Hey, you just better know your Bopo Mofos.
When I'm like maybe like 16 or 17, I don't know. I think I just go through some major identity crisis and I just really want to learn it. I take Mandarin class late at night. I ended up studying abroad.
That was huge.
In Shanghai.
Huge.
My junior year. I was there for like 4 months almost.
Unlike David, I did not grow up speaking Cantonese. I did not grow up speaking Mandarin. It was around in the household. I did not pick it up for whatever reason. I think mom and dad at that point, they thought I had a speech impediment growing up. So then they were like, yo, let's just teach this kid English because I don't know if he can handle 2 languages. Let's get into it, guys. The number one reason why ABCs are terrible at Chinese is because Chinese is a really hard language to learn. Let me throw out some stats, okay? Chinese is one of the few tonal languages in the world. It is the most widely spoken. It's not the only tonal language. Vietnamese, Hmong, Laos, and Thai have anywhere from 6 to 8 tones. Chinese, you know, Mandarin has 4. Cantonese, right. Some people say what? They have 6.
Well, just to explain to people what a tonal language means, it means that 2 words could sound the same, but based on the tone, they could be completely different.
It's like
high-low
pitches and
stuff. Yeah, so there's this one famous poem in Chinese that's 92 characters long, but of the same sound, and it tells a story. There's up to 50,000 characters as in pictures, hieroglyphics. It's like a pictographic logogram, whatever you want to call it. Okay, there's even a character called Biang that has 58 strokes in it. That's crazy. Now, 58 strokes.
That's crazy. It makes you not want to learn or write Chinese.
And let me tell you this, there's over 50,000 characters, but most people that are smart only know 10 to 12,000. And then to read the newspaper, you just need to know 1,000.
I had a teacher tell me, I was just get to 700. If you can get to 700, you could like
get around.
Be good enough on the internet and whatever.
And I think that speaking is one level hard because, you know, there's a lot of tones, but actually the reading and writing is next level because they're pictures.
And not only that, you learn to speak through learning the reading and writing. Oftentimes it helps to reinforce both sides.
Yeah,
even in Japan, they're starting to move away from kanji.
Yeah.
Because it's too hard. It's like limiting their system. They'd rather just spell it out with their alphabet.
And you know the language is hard when they got a simplified version for it.
Yeah. Dog, and the simplified version
is still hard.
It's still hard. Are you serious? Instead of 12 strokes, it's like 8 strokes.
Yeah.
Very simplified. Thank you. Now, it's funny because a lot of Asian countries like Japan and Korea were using the written Chinese language. Not necessarily speaking
Vietnam
Chinese.
Too.
And Vietnam were using the written Chinese language for many, many, many years. But up until like 100 or 200 years ago, they switched. And they were like, nah. We got to come up with our own. And I think they made it easier.
It's literally the last pictographic language left on Earth. Well, that would be like if the Egyptians kept hieroglyphics essentially as their form of communication.
No, there's a lot of Chinese characters that you can just pretty much easily draw them from the thing that they mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Chuar.
Yeah.
Dude, it looks chuar, like chuar looks almost exactly
you can't
like
get chuar wrong. I want to give Chinese props because it is also a very beautiful language. And for that reason, with all the pictures and all the strokes and calligraphy, it is beautiful in many ways, but it is hard. Character. Trust me. And I know you see John Cena and Mark Zuckerberg learning Chinese. They probably got top level tutors.
Yo, shout out to John Cena. Actually, I'll say this, better at Mandarin than Zuckerberg.
我不知道关于老干妈。 但是中国人说这是非常好的 chili sauce.
Pronunciation wise.
Really?
Zuckerberg has hella vocab. He has no tones.
我的中文很糟糕，但是我的天，谁用中文？
Number two reason why a lot of ABCs are terrible at Chinese is because growing up, especially growing up in the past, like, you know, 10, 15, 20 years, there was not a lot of cool ways to keep in touch with Chinese culture. Now, unless you were into C-pop, C-dramas, C-movies at the time, you were taking yourself out of a huge market of people who also speak Chinese in a bunch of ways that you could learn.
The Japanese kids could watch all this anime in language and be like, oh my gosh, that's like how my mom talks, or that's like how my grandma talks. Or the Korean kids can turn to like so much media that they legitimately think is cool and modern that's in language and be like, oh yeah, like I want to learn from everything from H.O.T. to 2PM to now Blackpink.
Now, Nelson, you grew up consuming a lot of like Hong Kong media and Cantonese media, right?
Nah, more so like if I would say like 70-80% Cantonese. I mean, there were some Mandarin tracks. Also growing up, you know, we watched a lot of, you know, Chinese drama. So
I mean, I would say the Taiwanese people had a little bit more to turn to for sure, whether you're talking about Jay Chou or Wang Li Home or something like that. They generally, the kids are good at Mandarin.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. Taiwanese kids, Taiwanese Americans generally are better at Mandarin.
From upper middle class families.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Especially from the educated families. So Taiwanese people do take a lot more pride in Mandarin than a lot of other groups of Chinese. That's a fact. Mm-hmm. My point number three is that even if kids know Mandarin and know Chinese or even Cantonese, they're not speaking a mixture of Chinglish, Chinese and English with each other when they hang out. We know that amongst ABCs, they're not mixing Chinese and English together, which would prolong and kind of boost the level of Chinese amongst the group and community.
One of our producers here, Justin, is Korean.
He's
not good at Korean. And he said that even people at his level that are not really that good at Korean still speak Konglish.
Right. Still try to use as much Korean as they can.
I know some Koreans who do that and they can't even really speak like two sentences in a row, but they're constantly saying the words they do know.
That's like me trying to throw in Chinese, which sometimes I do, but I oftentimes start a lot of conversations I can't continue.
芝麻, 一个绿豆.
Sometimes I start a combo I can't continue.
Yeah. Well, now, do you...
Nice question, Uber Eyes.
Yeah. Hey, I stop at... Oh, 你是哪里人吗? Oh, 好好... 我是...
山东人。
我最喜欢吃... 我的妈妈是...
I think Korea, South Korea, has seen so much westernization in the past 50 years that they don't even really look at it like East versus West as much. It's more like all blended into one fusion. Like, being Chinese is like very much like black and white, like... We are the East, they're the West. Mm-hmm. And to mix the two is like, won't work, or is not right, or just nobody does it.
I remember growing up, you were trying to rap in Chinese and I was trying to throw in some Chinese. And I think people just thought it was really weird because they were just like, you can't mix the two. Like,
I would never speak Chinglish for just an everyday thing. Like, yo, where are you going?
Could you come up with some Chinglish right now?
Well, I remember in Taiwan, sometime was like, yo, can you give me 你的号码? Like, because we were trying to organize the basketball team. And I remember just being like, oh, what?
So they greet you in yo, bro, which is kind of like the American, obviously, way of greeting. And then they're like, give me your number, Chinese.
Yeah, but I think that's too weird to me because there's no point in saying that in Chinese.
You are C-foothead.
Okay, like a...
Butthead.
Butthead.
Yeah. Okay.
Butthole head, actually. Specifically, anus ring head.
Oh. No, sometimes when we saw to say bad word like butt, we just say pigu instead of just saying the word butt.
Look at the pigu.
Did you see the pigu?
Whether it's real, whether it's right or wrong, a lot of ABCs feel like, even though they respect it, Chinese culture is just super outdated and uncool. That's facts. That's facts. The city. And I do not think that Korean Americans or Vietnamese Americans feel that way about their culture.
Speaking
like, of, I would say some of my Korean friends, sure, they think being Korean is cooler than being American. But definitely you will not meet any Chinese or Taiwanese Americans that would say that Chinese culture is cooler than America.
And that's why I think Taiwan, when we're talking about this level of adoration for Chinese culture, I think some of our Taiwanese friends have had it about Taiwanese culture, Chinese culture for a while, because Taiwan was a more pleasant and fun place to go back to growing up. Oh, while mainland China, to be honest, growing up, not up until like, you know, the past 10 years, and to this day, it's still kind of hard to get around, man. My WeChat's messed up.
Yeah. I mean, even if you go back to Hong Kong, Macau, people gonna catch you slipping. It's like the big city.
It is. Yeah.
It's
no, it
people,
is.
People ain't gonna be.
They gonna outsmart you, man.
Yeah, yeah. If they can get you, they'll get you.
It's the densest place like in the world. One of them.
Yeah. To me, Hong Kong, especially at a time growing up, it had a lot in common more with New York City.
All right, reason number four why Chinese is hard to learn and why a lot of ABCs suck at it is sometimes, and this is a short point, but which Chinese do you learn? Growing up, if you're Cantonese, there's a debate, especially 15 years ago, you're like, yo, I gotta learn Cantonese because that's my language I'm with. However, of course, nowadays in 2019, and I feel this way, and I feel for a lot of ABC Cantonese people, because now they're kind of sitting there being like, dang, man, I kind of wish I was studying Mandarin and would probably maybe affect my career if I had known it, but I spent most of my life learning my mother tongue, which is Cantonese. Mm-hmm.
Like David said, you know, the predominant Chinese language right now in 2019, you will have to say Mandarin.
If you're making that decision today.
Yes, today. Even though I would say I'm pretty fluent in Cantonese, I do want to learn Mandarin. I feel like Mandarin is the language that you need to know right now, whether, you know, you're doing business or media in terms of being in Asia or America or even around the world. I think Mandarin is such a powerful, you know, and strong language that it's very beneficial for you to have.
The movement of people like globally, like a lot of local dialects are being eliminated because it's no longer, there's too much movement. Like people moved cities and stuff like that. Like obviously previously in the world society, people just live and die in one zone.
Yeah.
So that lends itself to more local dialects. There has to be more standardization.
There are pros and cons to Mandarin being the number one language. That means some dialects will begin to dwindle in numbers of people who speak it, unfortunately.
Specifically in regions that have like high economic movement.
Funny story is that we're in New York years back and we meet this guy, Jimmy, and he's Fujianese. And then he asks us, like, yeah, do you guys speak Chinese? And then David, you're like, yeah, I speak Chinese. And then he starts speaking to us in Fujianese.
Kilikula.
Kilikula. Zipo? And then we're just like,
what?
We're like, hold up. Because that's the first time I heard Fujianese. And I was like, wait, that's what you consider Chinese? I'm talking about Mandarin and then Cantonese and then all the other dialects. You know, but from where he was coming from, his particular family situation and upbringing, he really thought the default Chinese was Fujianese.
I think you could see that same thing in Singapore too, like the Hokkien.
Yeah. What is Chinese in Singapore? Is it Hokkien or is it Mandarin?
Well, I think they would all know that Mandarin's the main one, but a lot of them, their best Chinese dialect is Hokkien.
Yeah. Reason number five, growing up, there was no real pressure to learn it. You didn't need to learn it for anything because you didn't have access to any secret parties or secret venues or cool things. It depends. In a small town, if you speak Chinese to the only other Chinese person, they might be like, oh, yeah. But, you know, in like the West Coast where there's a decent amount of Asians, if you speak Chinese to another person, it like doesn't really matter.
Well, I might have gotten better service for speaking Chinese.
Maybe, yeah. But like we don't really, like it's, you don't really get the hookup for being Chinese.
Well, I mean, it's the biggest group of people on planet Earth. They can't treat each other all that special.
There's so many of us, you know what I'm saying? Like what?
You live in a Chinese zone. You could have learned Mandarin in high school, but you chose Spanish.
Yeah.
Why is that?
You know, all the hot girls, you know, were taking Spanish. All the hot Asian girls, I was like, you know, I'm trying to...
Wait, you're saying that the popular cute girls at school didn't choose to take Mandarin class?
I'll tell you this, man.
What?
I took Chinese at UW, University of Washington. I guess like Jamie Chung, like whitewashed Asian chicks that is in the white sororities.
They got
neither of those girls is in Mandarin 101 at University of Washington. I don't know how it is nowadays.
No, I think in college there were some. Maybe that's why I took Mandarin in college, because I seen, you know.
Wow. You know, I can say for myself, one of my regrets in life, and this is not the craziest regret, but it is a regret, is that I did not take Chinese in college. I could have. I should have.
I just didn't do it.
I didn't choose to do it.
One of my biggest regrets is I didn't take Chinese in high school.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had this Chinese teacher, and then he was white. And I was like shook at the time. I was like, what? Your teacher is
like that? Like white.
He was Dashan.
There's late night party spots in Koreatown that you basically have to speak Korean and be Korean.
Yeah.
And you
couldn't even be Korean American and not speak Korean to really like fully be in part of that club.
Right. So actually I got to talk about one thing I was barred from, or someone was trying to reject me from, was the Chinese Student Association at UW. I ain't gonna call you out. She was from Beijing American School, and I knew the president of the CSA. You know, I was trying to be a good Chinese kid. You know, I'm like, oh, what's up? Like, I'm cool. Like, let me see what CSA is all about. Let me be an officer. But this girl was like, no, you're not Chinese. I was like, yeah, I'm Chinese. And she's like, no, you're not. And then I was like, hold up. Let me speak my bad Chinese real quick to let you know. And then she was like, yeah, I said, you're not Chinese. And I was like, oh.
Damn.
I was like, oh. But too bad I still got in. All right. Number six. Why also ABC sucks so bad at Chinese is that when you're trying to speak it and you're trying to learn in real life, people are super critical of you and will always try to correct you or basically tell you to stop. Now, there is kind of this, it feels like this feeling that when you try to speak Chinese to somebody and it's bad, they kind of say, like, do it right or don't do it at all. Like, don't bring in that bad Chinese, man. Just speak to me in English. And you're just like, I'm trying to practice here, man. And they're like, I don't got time for this. I don't got time for this.
I remember I was talking to my cousin. I wanted to, you know, speak Cantonese and like text him in Cantonese, but it was so bad. He's like, dude, what are you doing? Just stop. Just say it in English. And I was like, man, I'm just trying to, you know, enhance my Cantonese language.
It really puts you in a sink or swim proposition. There's no middle ground. And I think that really, when I think about it, that's actually what encouraged me to swim. It doesn't allow for slow development.
And there's no dog paddling?
Yeah, that's it.
No dog paddling?
There's no doggy
paddling.
That's
me, bro. That's me.
It's either like you tread in water like an Olympian, or like at least like a varsity swimmer. Or you just sink it to the bottom and just dying.
Yeah, I don't. Obviously, I think you had a stronger desire, of course, growing up to do it. And shout out to you. And for me, that's what I regret, is that I only got the desire like later in life.
Well, they say the language cutoff age, I'm not gonna lie, guys, it's 34.
Nah,
they said your brain cements at 34.
I don't believe that.
It's a wrap after 34.
My brain is not the same, David. If you date a Chinese girl in America, she's gonna want to learn English. Like, I dated a fob.
From China.
From Dongbei. She was actually like really fob because she came here after college. And she did teach me some Chinese, but it wasn't like how you think. Like, everybody's like, oh, date a Chinese girl, you'll learn Chinese. We're in America, man. I'm still trying to operate. Like, you still got to operate and get things done. You can't spend your whole life learning Chinese. I'm not like some guy who moved back to China to teach English and all I'm doing is chilling and learning English. Like, I got a business to run. So it was hard.
If you guys know about, like, over there, they don't listen for the sound of the vocab. They listen for the tone. So you could be saying the word with the wrong tone and you can't understand why they can't just figure out that your tone was wrong. Right. They don't listen that way. Their processor processes tone first.
Do you think people are now getting used to it a little bit more?
Well, because they're speaking to so many foreigners. Foreigners are more phonetic based.
Yeah.
Sound based.
That they're more using context. And also a lot of the popular Chinese rap now does not have perfect tones, because a lot of the rappers are from like places like Sichuan where their style of Mandarin is already different.
Kind of like mumbling and stuff.
People used to give Jay Chow a lot of crap because when he would sing, he would eliminate the tones.
Yeah,
but you're right. The younger generation, I think, of Chinese people, they're more listening for the phonetics and the context mixed with the tone, not just tone only.
I like that better. I do think Cantonese, they understand the phonetics a little bit better. Like, I think they're more used to it. The lazy tones. I don't know. That's my feeling when I speak it.
Saying Cantonese properly is more difficult from your throat, but the Cantonese gives you a more leeway on the grammar.
Number seven, let's move along. All right, let's finish this. Okay, a lot of Chinese parents want their kids to achieve so bad that they just teach their kids English or just make sure that they speak good English because they want them to go as far in America as possible. And especially if you're talking about college exams and taking tests, yes, it's true. In America, you do not need to know Mandarin. I do think learning another language can make you smarter in a different way, helps you think in a different way. However, there is no SAT question that is about Mandarin. So if you're a parent, I'm not defending the parents right now, but if you're a parent and you just want your kid to succeed in America as much as possible, and this was a lot of the thinking for most people, you'll just make sure they know English well. All right, now another reason why a lot of ABCs are not good at Chinese is because, first of all, there are so many different types of Chinese, so many different levels of education, different levels of westernization, and a lot of Chinese parents who made it to America and survived and did their thing, they weren't necessarily formally educated. So like even their reading and writing level of Chinese is not even like top level.
No, that's true. My parents didn't even make it to middle school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So well, you would say your parents are not the best at reading and writing Chinese.
Yeah, they could probably like get by. Right. They have to like ask each other, hey, how do you write this word or something like that, you know?
The ability to handwrite Chinese is like vanishing. Like everybody's typing pinyin.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Or speaking it and then you just
speaking it in the phone and letting it.
Like you said, WeChat, you know? Yeah.
I'll just say this, man. Chinese culture is so ancient. It's going to be interesting to see how it develops in the modern world and how it integrates and how it. And I'll just tell you this. Nobody's going to be able to predict it.
Dog.
It's just going to look like something else.
Hey, you know, and this is a very ABC perspective. I'll push for pinyin. I'm a fan of pinyin.
Hey, me too.
And I'm not going to lie. Chances are, especially at this point in my life, I'm probably never really going to learn how to write Chinese. I mean, it's pretty safe to say that.
I mean, why put limits on yourself?
Right. Never say never.
Never say never.
Never tell yourself that you can't do anything. Trust the process.
Trust the process. That's a fact. What? We got to wrap this up. But basically, that was technically 9 reasons why ABCs suck at Chinese. Now, I'm not saying all ABCs are bad. There's plenty of ABCs who learn, plenty of ABCs that were raised with it. But if you guys know a large number of Chinese Americans, you will know that a lot of them,
the majority,
over 50%, are not good at Chinese. I have been actually looking to learn Chinese. I think everybody else out there should take a stab at it. I'm not saying you necessarily got to dedicate your life. Maybe it doesn't fit inside of your life right now and you've already decided that you don't need it. But if you are going to say you're proud of Chinese, you got to know something. That's all I got to say. Obviously, that's my perspective as someone who doesn't know it. So
I've been telling Andrew, man, you're trying to take that Chinese class at one of those colleges. I'm with you.
Thank you so much. In the comments below, let us know if it's also been hard for you to learn Mandarin or any other Chinese dialect. Let us know in the comments below. Let us know if this was relatable. And please share this with your friends if you want to have this discussion with them.
And shout out to everybody else, too. I didn't mean this to be exclusive to only Chinese people, but it's just like, I mean, we're just having a conversation, so.
Hey, guys.
Hey, shout out to the Koreans and Viets and all.
Hey, everybody. That's facts. Until next time, guys. Hop, hop, boys. We out.
Peace.